You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames Podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth.
So, if you had told me in early 2018 that I'd be sitting where I am today doing this, I would have thought you had lost your mind. Now, I will say in 2018, I got invited to be a guest on the Mighty Blue podcast. Now, if you're not already listening to the Mighty Blue podcast, well, I would be really shocked because most of my listeners certainly are. It's a fantastic podcast and it's all about Steve, our producer, and he talks to AT people all over the place. And it really is our mothership, so to speak. But he asked me to be a guest. I was super flattered and I had a lot of fun doing it. And it was shortly after that that he called me and he said, "Hey, Anna." Actually, I'm pretty sure he said, "Hey, Bud, what do you think about doing your own podcast?" And I'll be honest with you, I knew nothing at all about podcasts, but I did know a whole lot of cool people. And I was like, this sounds like fun. Let's try it. So do you know where we are today? Today is our 200th episode. I am just as shocked as you are. That is 200 times that we have heard from extraordinary people. We've heard amazing stories. We've been inspired. We've cried. We've laughed. All that great stuff. And I'm, again, just as shocked as I can be that we're here and proud beyond belief. So what are we doing today for the 200th episode? Well, for my longtime listeners, you might remember episode number one. We talked to Carla Robertson from Living Wild and Precious Life Coaching. And she actually has been a guest on the show one other time, but today she's back. And I thought she was the perfect guest to come for episode 200. We're going to talk about hiking alone in the woods and being present and creating your own special relationship with nature. It is a beautiful episode. It's gentle, it's easy, and it is for everyone. And I'm going to let this episode stand on its own. There's not an Anna Mudbutt AT journal entry afterwards. We'll get back to that next time. But for now, I want you to sit back and I want you to listen to Carla and our conversation about loving nature. My name is Anna. All my friends call me Mudbutt. And you're listening to the 200th episode of the Trail Dames podcast. Carla, welcome back to the podcast.
Thank you so much. Congratulations on the 200th episode.
Well, thank you. I don't think I ever even thought about getting this far, but I blinked and it happened. And the thing that is so special to me is at my very, very first episode ever, you were the guest. And now when I go back and I listen to it, when I listen to myself, I cringe because, you know, I didn't know what I was doing and I was nervous and everything, but you were so gracious and fantastic. And now have you back. And it's actually not your second time, it's your third time. And I just love revisiting you and seeing what all's going on in your life.
Oh, thank you so much. It is really just an honor to be here and chat.
Fantastic. Well, let's start chatting. I do want to just jump in. Our listeners will remember. They'll remember you from several things. You know, you have been so active in our summits, our conferences we've had. You've been an award winner with us and a keynote speaker and all this kind of stuff. But the thing that most people know about you is Living Wild and Precious. And this is not only your coaching business, which I want to tell all of our listeners that I have actually used her coaching, and it's quite extraordinary, actually. But it's also become a fundamental part of how you see the world And will you remind us and our new listeners what that means to you or where that came from?
Oh, sure. So yeah, there is a poet named Mary Oliver. She's an incredible poet, and she actually spent a lot of time in the woods alone. And she had an incredible ability to take her experience and turn it into poetry. And a long time ago, when I was a very busy teacher and very overwhelmed, I saw this one line from her poem, which is called The Summer Day. And I saw it at the base of a bench in a park. And it just said, "Tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life?" And I started to cry. I thought, oh my goodness, my one wild and precious life, wild and precious, my one wild and precious life. And it just overwhelmed me with like, oh, wow. This is important. And I saw that quote before I ever hiked the whole Appalachian Trail. And that was one of the things that was something I really wanted to do with my wild and precious life. So what's also really wonderful about this poem, because sometimes the words in this poem can feel almost like a pressure to, you know, get a lot done and, you know, get your bucket list out. But really the poem is about her sitting in a field with a grasshopper on her hand and doing nothing and being idle and blessed in that moment on this summer day. And, you know, it's like, tell me, what else should I have done? Doesn't everything die and too soon? Tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? So, and I didn't even know that part when I first experienced the poem. So that's, yes, it's very much, very much about how I live and how I try to remember what's important to me.
Well, I have to tell you, I didn't know that part of the story either. And you literally just kind of took my breath away with the statement, being idle and blessed. And I don't know if I've ever, I hope I felt like that at some point, but it just, those words just filled me and they gave me a new, I don't want the word goal. You know, they gave me a new way to approach being. And yeah. I love that. Well, you know, and you said that she spent a lot of time alone in the woods. Is that something you do?
Yes, as much as I can. I feel like, especially these past few years, it has been so great for my mental health and just so important to me to spend quiet time in nature. Doing not a whole lot of anything sometimes.
Well, let me ask
but I'm doing
you,
a lot.
You are doing a lot. Let me ask you, because you mentioned you have through hiked the Appalachian Trail mm-hmm. with that whole thing that goes along mm-hmm. with that, you know, and I know that you've done a lot of things in between being alone and at peace on a hike and the Appalachian Trail. Do you remember the first time you actually felt at peace in the woods? Did it happen automatically? Like, did it just happen gradually?
Wow. I think I would have to go back to childhood. I really think.
Oh, wow.
Now, maybe some of that wasn't all alone, but even, I mean, our backyard, it was a tiny little patch of woods, you know, but it was woods. And I was out there sitting around, you know, looking at leaves, looking at bugs, or just being sitting in a tree. So I feel like it goes way back. In fact, I remember when I was hiking the AT and going through, I grew up in New Jersey. So walking through the woods in New Jersey and Pennsylvania, where there was a lot of honeysuckle and poison ivy and just the smell. And it just felt so like home and like safe and good. So I think I felt at peace in the woods that was my place. For, you know, in Girl Scout camp, you know, that sort of thing.
Oh, now see, and I didn't do that. But I have to tell you that it makes me kind of envious because I remember when I was dreaming, I was starting to hike and I was an adult woman and I was dreaming of attempting the Appalachian Trail. And I read a book. I read every book on the AT, you know.
Sure.
And I couldn't even tell you which one it was. And it was written by a woman. And she talked about sitting on the grass and with kind of with her legs out in front of her crossed and looking down and some baby stick insects were walking across her thigh, you know, and looking down at them and just seeing, oh, how cool that is. And I remember at that moment thinking, I want to feel that much a part of nature and at home and at peace, you know. And for me, it didn't happen until I was later on the Appalachian Trail. So to feel that way as a child is got to be amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. And I imagine that people listening, some people will remember that. And what's strange is sometimes, you know, just even playing outside, we sort of forget how comfortable we were just playing and picking up leaves and sitting in the grass and sitting and not worrying about being dirty or worrying about very much of anything. And then as we go into adulthood, we start to add these layers of like, it has to have, you know, another goal. We have to be getting exercise or we're, you know, some other kind of equipment or something that we're using to experience time when we go out in nature, that it can't just be sort of a free time.
Oh yeah. There's all those layers and, right. And to make sure you're not only wearing the right clothes according to right. the books, but also, does it look good? You know, like if somebody walks by you, are you going to look like a homeless person or like a real hiker? I used to always worry about looking like a real hiker.
Yeah, so
you're carrying all that stuff. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So did you ever carry those kind of ideals when you were hiking? I have to go this fast. I have to make this many, you know, make a climb this big. Or did you always kind of settle into the idea of letting it unfold as a hike?
Yeah, well, it's interesting. I'm sure there have been plenty of times where in my mind, I would be saying, oh, I should be going, I wish I was going faster. I should be getting here, or everybody else seems to be going faster than me. But, you know, when I think about my big hike, my big AT hike, from the very beginning, even what I told myself was, I am not going to worry about it. I'm going to go as slow as I want to go. I'm here. I'm not achieving my goal was not to achieve an athletic feat. My goal was to be in the woods, even then. And so that meant stopping when I felt like stopping. And that's still something that, So now I haven't been doing much like long-term backpacking recently, but I have been going and just sleeping out in the woods. I have, lucky to have a friend with land that's about an hour and a half drive from my house, and there's a creek and there's, about 11 acres and I can be out there and there's nobody except me and nature. And I'll set my tent up sometimes right at the edge of the creek or in the woods. And so at that point, then I'm not worrying about anything about anybody else because there's no one else around. And then I can really just be, you know, and that's what I do.
So when I've talked to friends about going out into the woods by themselves, the first thing that comes up so often is the fears, and we're going to get back to that. But I want to ask you about the thing that so many of them tell me, and I frankly will be honest with you, I deal with all the time, and that's not being able to turn their head off. Mm-hmm. You know, they'll find a beautiful rock somewhere, mm-hmm. and you know, there's birds and little sun coming down through the trees, and that brain is just going, you know.
Yeah.
Do you have any advice for that?
Sure. Yeah, that totally makes sense too, especially because these days, especially we are just bombarded with input all the time and feel this our brains are searching for something to be thinking about, or we're looking at something. I would say for me, here's what I'll say. Even now, when I go away to this beautiful property that I love so much, it takes a little while to settle in. It's not just like this magical, oh, I'm like, you know, nature girl, and all of a sudden I'm just connected with everything. A lot of times I have to sit in that same, there's that same kind of tick, tick, ticking in my brain. And it really, to me, I think it's just about letting that be and staying, not abandoning the plan too soon. It just takes some time. And then eventually I'll find, I will often go and sit by this creek, especially in the summer when it's, you know, really hot, but the creek is cool. And once I've, you know, I like to go out for two nights a lot of times because, you know, the first afternoon there is a little more brain, you know, moving around and stuff.
Monkey mind.
And then eventually, yeah, exactly. Then I just sit with my feet in the creek or sit and I just watch these little fish. And I can do that for a really long time. And, you know, I can even then have this part of my brain that's like, you should be more productive or what are you doing? But really at this point, I'm like, no, this is what I'm doing. I'm being idle and blessed, basically. And it is like the most renewing thing for my mind and body to just sit and be that way. But yeah, it does take a while. And I think a lot of times we don't stay long enough and we're like, oh, it didn't happen the first 5 minutes or the first 15 minutes or even the first half hour. So there must be something wrong with me and I can't do it. And I would say, sit for longer, hang out longer.
I think that that's so true for so many things in this world that I can tell, I will just speak for myself. And that is that discomfort, sitting with discomfort, and we're not talking great discomfort, you know, just sitting with that little discomfort, it's hard. And I always, it makes me want to jump up and check Facebook or jump up and, oh, I should read a book, you know.
Yeah, sure. And yeah, and you know, there's little things that you can do for yourself in those moments. There are little things to just close your eyes and just listen, see what you sounds you hear, see how far away the sounds are, where what you're noticing, you know, things to just slow your breathing, feel the ground under you, you know, different kinds of ways to kind of settle in, look for colors. You know, and a lot of times I might start with something like that. And then I've just wandered around or I've gotten curious. I'm like, oh, what's that? Or I'm just looking or I'm looking at gravel. I'm looking at little rocks or I'm looking at the clouds and just letting my mind go.
Do you get lonely when you do that?
I personally don't. I love my alone time. And so I don't feel lonely. Now I do have, I have one good friend that I will invite to come with me on trips like this because she understands and the two of us know how to be quiet or go do our own thing a little bit, you know? And so sometimes it's nice to have company. The times that it can be nice to have company, a lot of times for us humans are like, when we're sitting and eating our meal, you know, there's those different times where we want to tell somebody something or talk a little more. And if you're by yourself, you eat by yourself. But really when I'm completely alone, I don't feel lonely. I feel, just happy generally, or maybe I'm not happy. I'm not always happy. I'm just me. Maybe I'm thinking about something that happened before and not happy, but I'm there happy to be by myself. Yeah.
Well, I feel the same way when I'm alone. So I understand. Yeah. I don't remember being lonely once in the last 20, 30 years.
Yeah. So. And the other thing that I've noticed is that the best wildlife encounters I have are always when I'm alone. Because I'm quiet and my energy is different and I'm not chit-chatting or, you know, making a lot of noise. And it's just incredible the experiences I've had just being still and quiet and the animals that come by, you know.
Well, and that is so, I got giggling because in Trail Dames, we have a saying that we don't see a lot of wildlife. We are the wildlife. And, but the truth of the matter is because of the noise, you know, the general energy that we are walking down the trail, we don't have many wildlife experiences. And I tell people, I don't tell everybody, well, I guess I am tonight, but like one of my most wonderful outdoor moments by myself was sitting on a rock with my eyes closed and I could hear a snake going through the leaves. It wasn't a scary snake. It was a big, black, beautiful snake. But I could listen to him go through the leaves. And the few people I've mentioned that to before tonight, they're always like, snakes. And, you know, and they talk about being afraid of the wildlife. Mm-hmm. I mean, do you find wildlife scary? I usually do not, but I'm a little weird. We've established.
No, I don't. To me, it is such a gift, like what you described, being there with the snake. And the snake is a distance from you and it's living its life, its wild and precious life. And it's just going about its day in a place that has everything it needs. And to me, that's the most wonderful thing, whether you're watching an insect or a snail, I'll watch a snail or I watch this, they have a lot of these along the eastern woodlands. I've seen them in Shenandoah. They're those big millipedes. They're dark gray, but they're big, like 3 inches long.
Yep.
And they have them at this property, and I was watching this millipede come down the beach, get in the water, and get back out and go back in the woods. And I was like, that I have never seen it, and I just sat there and watched and didn't interfere, didn't interrupt. And there was no need to be afraid or, concerned, just watching. I looked up later that they need moisture, and maybe this little one just needed to get a little bit wet and go back in the woods. I don't know.
Which is funny, because I had to tell myself the story that he was enjoying a nice cooling dip to get away from the heat,
But it was just, it's these little moments. They're not always giant mammals. I mean, I've had really cool things happen with like otters and deer and, the kind of, things that were so excited, the fuzzy animals with pretty eyes and stuff. But they're all, just watching the fish interact, and they'll be like, oh, there's a couple different species of fish here, and some of them are hanging out at the top of the water and some of them are along the bottom, and just watching them do their thing. I feel like, just like we were talking about, it takes time to be able to calm your mind and not feel that antsiness. It takes time to sit in the woods and not feel like you need to be on alert for every other wild creature that's out there, that you need to worry about it. And to me, I think that's one of the things that makes me wish that, I'm sure there are some people listening who are like, oh yeah, I totally get this, I do this all the time. And other people are like, I think I would like to, but I don't know. But I feel like what happens if we don't do enough of this is we get really disconnected from other living things, and we start doing weird things like hiring people to come and kill every bug in our yard outside, not in the house, like outside the house, where the birds need to eat those little bugs. And we forget that this is food for birds, and we get upset that there's something coming out of the tree, whether it's leaves or acorns, and that are falling. And so we want to cut down the tree so that we don't have to clean off our driveway or our pool or our car. And we forget who lives in these trees and that we're not the only, that's like, we just get really disconnected. And that's heartbreaking to me personally.
I agree when that totally. Happens. I always think about dandelions. Whether they're the little poofy ones or the yellow ones, and the people that think that that's marring their beautiful lawn. And I'm like, oh no, that's the pretty part,
Right. Really? Yeah, I know. And I live in a city, so I think I really feel it even more, because, I sit out every day, and every morning my cat and I go and sit in our little lawn, and it might only be for 5 minutes, or if I have a long time, it might be a half an hour. Or it might be longer, depending. And I just sit and see what's going on in the yard. So I know the squirrels and the blue jays and all the little bugs and the butterflies and all the animals that share this space that are wild, And it means a lot to me.
That I can totally understand. And I think you said something when we don't go out there, becoming more and more disconnected.
Yeah.
I think too, if we are not going out there, the fears that we have about going out get bigger and they get more powerful, and we kind of blow them up out of proportion without even knowing it. And so, so assume that we have 1,000 women listening to this that have never experienced this, have never gone outside by themselves. They'll go with friends or with groups. How do you tell them to approach the first time?
Yeah, well, I would say start where you are. So wherever, whatever you have done, see what feels like the next step and play with that. So if you have like taken walks by yourself in parks and things, and that feels comfortable and you want to do like a little more of an overnight, you can, you know, you can even do overnights in state parks, or somewhere where there's like a campground, and set something up. Or if you've not really done anything, like just take a walk by yourself in a local trail, and do something short and see what happens and see how it feels and go a little further than you thought you could. An interesting thing I just read about recently that I thought was a great idea is if you're staying somewhere that's where there's a bunch of other people, somebody described that she puts out two chairs by the campfire, even if she's by herself. So then it's just, there's this feel, you know, so there's this just feeling or quality of, you know, somebody is around. But I would, you know, I went through this, a process like this when I was first trying to not be afraid of the dark outside, you know, like I loved the woods, but I did not, had not spent any time outside alone in the dark by myself. And so I had to, you know, I played with this over a long period of time, and there was a trail, beautiful trail in the wetlands that I started taking by myself at sunset. And so you go at sunset and then it gets dark and then you walk back in the dark. And, you know, the first times it's a little intense, even though nothing is happening and nothing is going, you know, there's nothing happening, but inside your head, but it feels intense. You know, and then if you're scared of anything supernatural, like ghosts or anything like that, then there's that hope. I feel like I always have to tell that like part of myself that's in fourth grade. I'm like, it's okay, you know. Or if we think of it, it's going to make them show up, you know, that kind of silly stuff that happens. So, but I've had so many neat experiences just taking a walk by myself, whether it's daytime, nighttime, whatever. But back to your question of how to start. Whatever your mind is telling you about, oh, that's impossible. I guess a good place to start also is like, why? Why would you like to try this? If it does feel appealing, what are the advantages, or what are you looking to experience? And then what's the smallest, easiest way to start to experience that and see what happens? One thing that I love to do, and I do this when I'm by myself on a, like I'll visit friends and then I want to go on a hike and they're working that day or something, and I go on a hike in an unfamiliar place, is I will always take my breaks. I get way off, not way off the trail, but I step off the trail into like, I'll find little place. If I want to just be by myself, it is so easy to be by yourself in very popular places. If you just go just a little ways, you know, make sure you're oriented so you don't get turned around, you know, but just a few steps even. Nobody's, people are on the trail and they don't even look to the left and the right. And especially if there's a little bit of, you know, cover or like a creek. A creek is a great place to do. So there's like a creek crossing, and then just go up or down the creek just a little ways and find a pretty rock and sit there and let yourself have no agenda.
That's the thing. No agenda.
Mm-hmm. Bring a snack. I'm a big fan of, like, you know, we were talking about discomfort before. When I do this, I like to be comfortable, as comfortable as I can. So I'm going to bring all my little snacks. I'm going to bring my different clothes in case it's got too hot or too cold. I'm going to have my layers. I'm going to have something nice to sit on, like a pad, or even a trash bag works, you know, but just something to separate me. I'm going to have any, if I do need any kind of repellent, depending on the time of year, you know, or just different insects that you do have to be more concerned about. I want to be careful about that. But I'm going to make it comfortable so that I can go sit for a while and I have a snack and I can just sit there and enjoy. Yeah.
Well, and I have to tell you what I really appreciate. And I appreciate that you sharing about a time when you weren't comfortable outdoors in the dark and getting more comfortable, because I have been guilty for so many years, especially in my little bit younger years, whenever I really looked up to people that I aspired to be like them, you know, whether it was in the hiking community or the music or whatever. But I always assumed they pooped out of the womb, just like they are, fully formed, you know, completely evolved, and that I would never be that evolved. And whenever people share that they went on their own journey for comfort, you know, from discomfort to comfort, whatever journey it was, I appreciate it so much.
Oh yeah. And you know, the stuff you were talking about, I mean, I have so many stories about how I'm not legit, or I'm not a legit outdoors person because I'm not, you know, going on a trek to Kilimanjaro or whatever. And I don't really love altitude, to be honest, which is why I love the Eastern woodlands, because they're not high altitude. And I love being in the woods. You know, I'm one of these people who doesn't need a big vista. Like, I love being under the trees, you know? And so all of that, I can tell myself a story of like, well, you're not really, you know, or you don't have this kind of gear, or you're not into this, or you don't have that, you know, I'm really just I still would say a girl who just wants to go sit in the woods, you know? And so some people would be like, well, what is that? That doesn't seem very...
Well, let me ask you, because, you know, we're talking about a lot of the emotional payback we get from being out in the woods, mm-hmm. and the spiritual and peace. So my trail dames who have never gone on a hike by themselves, the first thing they always say to me is, it's not safe because of other people. Yeah. And I have found in my life, it's been safe all the time. And, you know, and I always want to say, it is safe. It's fine. You know, it's fine. Just go for it. But I don't think that's a very good answer. Like, how did you do?
Yeah, well, it's probably safe. And if it's not safe, you're going to do the best you can with whatever happens. And that has been really helpful to me, because there were certainly a few times when I was by myself on the Appalachian Trail hiking and just got a little bit of a vibe or something. Nothing bad ever happened to me. Nothing bad ever happened. But just these little moments where you're like, or mostly it would be like, what if? That person might know where I'm going to, that person is over there, and even somebody without any kind of a quote unquote vibe, I'm just starting to think or worry. And so then it's all in my head, all of the things. I mean, this happened to me around Blood Mountain in Georgia, which is a place a lot of the trail dames go all the time, because there was a murder not that far from there. And mm-hmm. she was a black belt and she had a dog, you know, and that's the thing that people... They tell that story. And so I was alone, and it was a horrible day, and I'm worked up, and I can remember that day still where I was. And this is the end of my hike, because I was a southbounder at that point. So I have 2,000 miles under my belt, and I'm still freaking out, just to clarify that these things happen. And then I finally had to say to myself for the 20th time, if something happens to you, you're just going to do the best you can. And that's all you can ask yourself. You know, if they're going to cut you up in little pieces and bury you in the woods, you know, there's nothing, you know, you're going to do the best you can. I'm sorry to make it sound, you know, and so that kind of helped me, that I didn't have to try to, you know, like I would say, like in my mind, I'd be like, I'm not going to be able to reason with a crazy person. If there's a crazy person and something happens, I'm just going to have to do the best I can. And so that's how I kind of go. And then I have a lot of experience where nothing bad has happened.
That's the way I am.
Yeah. And, you know, one of my favorite relatively recent experiences was I took a 3-night solo trip to Yosemite National Park.
Really?
So that felt to me like such a, and this was just car camping, but to go to such a famous national park by myself, like who does that? Who goes by themselves to such a, you know, and it was the most delicious, like personal retreat for me. So I'm in a campground, I'm by myself, and, you know, but it was, you know, I guess something could have happened, but nothing happened, you know, nothing, nobody bothered me, no problems, nobody even interacted with me. And I really spent the time by myself. And I can remember there was a big bunch of like a rocky outcrop behind my tent that I climbed up to this little area that there was nobody, you know, no trails, nothing, and not far, you know, but it was far enough that no one was there, and just sitting there for like at least an hour, you know, not taking some famous trail. I'm in Yosemite National Park and I'm just some random place behind my tent in up in the rocks, up with all these beautiful pine trees, and watching this mother mule deer and her two babies come romping along in the distance. And, you know, it was just me and them. And I did take some of the famous hikes too. I walked to some of the famous falls and there was a ton of people around, but I was by myself and I got to decide when to stop and when to eat. And that's one of the things I love about being on my own as well, is that self-reliance and getting to decide, not having to negotiate where, when are we going to do this? When are we going to do that? I just get to experience it by myself. And so that's another way for people who are like, I don't know, like go somewhere really popular, but go by yourself.
I love it. And you that know? Takes care of all the family that's worried about you being safe.
Yeah.
You know, you could say, yeah, oh, I'll be surrounded by people and you're telling the
right.
truth.
And if anything goes wrong, somebody will help you.
Exactly. And they will. Yes.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I mean,
especially
yeah,
at exactly. campgrounds, you know,
right.
campgrounds are full of the most helpful people in the
that's
entire world.
That's so true. Yeah. That's so true. Yeah.
So, you mentioned something when we were emailing back and forth before we got on the recording, and you said you were talking about how to create your own special relationship with nature. So how would you tell a woman to go about creating her own relationship with nature?
Yeah, well, again, I would say start close to home so that you don't have to go far. If even like literally my yard is 30, like I sit in a patch that's like 30 feet by 50 feet. I can see the port from my house. I can hear them unloading the docks, but there's squirrels. There's just things happening. And so for me, that has been important to find what the nature close to home and watch and be present with it. And for some people, you know, some people have bird feeders, you know, people do all kinds of things. But I think sometimes we don't even give ourselves credit for that. So the story we're telling ourselves is I'm disconnected. I don't do, you know, I don't know anything. I don't know enough about this or that, or I don't do these things. And then you find out, oh, they're feeding birds and they're doing this. And so you are connected. And then I would say, you know, finding the places that are close to home that feel wild to you, that feel a little wilder in a way that's appealing to you, whatever that might be. It can be friends' property. It can be parks. It's amazing. I'm always searching. I'm one of these people that's always going to the little part that didn't get mown, or the little part that's kind of like nobody's paying attention to, or the little part that's like a little more overgrown. Because that's where all the fun, that's like where all the cool things are happening versus the part that somebody, you know, mowed. And, you know, but that may not be true for someone listening. They might want to sit at a picnic table. There's always a lot. If you're under big, tall trees, there's a ton of stuff going on overhead as well. And so you can kind of just be present with that. And different people will like different landscapes. You'd hear me talking about the woods all the time because I love being under the trees. That is my happy place. But I love going to the beach too. And I love just sitting and, being out at for sunrise and sunset and, just listening and sitting and watching. So yeah, I would say start close to home and then keep going to the places that feel appealingly wild and let yourself hang out for longer than you usually do without an agenda and see what happens. And then I also like to go back to the same places personally, because then you start to get to know, you know, or you see them in different seasons and they become like another like familiar place. And that's also, to me, for me personally, you're asking about personal connection with nature. It's like, oh, here's the otter path. Oh, here's where I saw the otter last time. Here's where this den is, or here's where I wonder what's going on. Oh, here's where the old nest was. I wonder if anybody's come back this year, or they're going to rebuild here. Those kinds of things, you know, so you get layers of memories and layers of connection. So even if you have a visit where nothing quote unquote big happens, you know, no deer comes by, or, you know, a big mammal or a exciting thing, there's still something happening, and those layers just keep building. And that's, to me, what brings that peace and connection.
I love that. There's no words for how much I love that, I have to say. So, and I just appreciate you so much saying, step into what appeals to you. Mm-hmm. Because I had not even thought about it, as soon as you said, some people have bird feeders, I have friends that their backyard might as well be, Noah's Ark of birds, right. You know, it's like just, and they they sit out on their chair and they tell me all about them, and they can, not only do they know the types, but I have friends that name them, you know, sure. And they know their personalities. And this is exactly what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't all have to look alike. It just has to be what speaks mm-hmm. to you.
Exactly. Totally.
Well, I also want to say, and my friends that listen to this, they've heard me talk about this so many times, but, one of the greatest lessons that I've gotten came from you. And I tell people, so you and I attempted to take a week-long Appalachian Trail backpack trip some years ago. And mm-hmm. you wrote out the itinerary. And at the end of every day, you wrote the words, should you choose to end your trip here? And then you had instructions, because the idea was there was going to be more than just you and I. There was going to be all these people, and then people could decide if they wanted to do mm-hmm. 2 days or 3 days or 4 days. And that crawled into my psyche. It became such this amazing freedom, because I was so used to before that you set your plans and that's your plans. And if you don't do your plans, you have failed at your plans. You failed mm-hmm. totally. And I have taken that, and I've applied that to all kind of things, not just hiking, but mm-hmm. this idea that you taught me, that almost kind of go where the current takes you, so to speak, you know, and don't mm-hmm. hold yourself to these things because it was written on a piece of paper, but follow your instinct and your heart. And it's a wonderful, wonderful way of looking at things.
It's such a nice way to live. Yeah, because most of what we tell ourselves is stuff that we made up. And so if we made it up, we can just change our minds, be like, oh, I don't want to do that anymore.
That right there.
You know, we were supposed to see 5 things today, but I'm tired. And these 2 things I saw were great. And now I really just want to sit, or I want to stay longer with this one thing that's so cool, you know, or whatever, or I'm tired. Yeah. Or oh gosh. And that trip we took, we could do a podcast about that. It was just incredibly joyful. I just remember
it really was
just all of the joy and doing it how we felt like and having a great time.
Watching you was like a masterclass in finding joy in the outdoors, because the things you talk about, this is how you actually move through the woods. It's great. Yeah. You'd be walking along and you'll be like, ooh, some water. And oh, look at these pretty pebbles down here. And oh, did you see that butterfly? And it's so wonderful because you are noticing the small things. You're seeing beauty on a lot of sizes. I think, like, you know, you said big things didn't happen. Mm-hmm. You know, we're mm-hmm. so used to, we want a big vista. We want, oh, that was a mm-hmm. giant log across a giant water crossing. But watching you enjoy the little things, that was also, it was just fantastic for me to see and to learn from. And
oh, well, thank you. And the times that we've, you know, had our gatherings and I've done those little morning walks, I call them wordless walks, because we all are quiet, which is what allows us to kind of have those connections. And we will be on a college campus and we will find the coolest stuff, you know, tiny little, some little wildflowers here, some little lichen or some little bugs or birds or trees or sky. It's just it's everywhere. And that's, I think, to me, that magic can come from like nature is all around us all the time if we just tune in.
Yeah.
And yeah.
Yeah.
And I also love going to new places, you know, like if anybody's listening to this and be like, oh, I love going and finding these little places and little parks and supporting people to figure out like what's a cool place near you, you know, that's like some of my favorite things to do. And I live in New Orleans and it can be a challenge, you know, in some ways, but I have found, especially during the pandemic, so many beautiful little trails close by and little places where you can go and be in the woods by yourself or with someone else if you want.
Yeah. And who knew in New Orleans? Because, you know, yeah. I went to LSU and if you had said how many hiking trails around here, I would have been like, you know,
none.
One,
right.
Two, none. Yeah, exactly. So yeah. You're doing something locally now, aren't you? Tell us what you're doing in the mornings.
So I have an offering that I call Awake in Wonder. And there's something so neat about being outside at dawn and watching it go from dark to light and everybody waking up. And so this is a one-on-one. It's like a mini retreat and it's a one-on-one experience. So it's very customized. So I work with whoever's meeting with me or wanting to do this, and we make something very special just for them. Most recently, I worked with a person who we chose places that were close to where she lived. So they were a little ways away from me. So I had to get up extra early. But it was so neat to experience together these places that were very close for her. And to sit and be still and quiet in the woods and watch it get light. And generally this experience, you're not going for a long, long hike. It's much more, a lot of sitting and being, and we usually have a little breakfasty picnic. And it's just magical. But again, it's pretty customized and it's fun. And it's, if you're listening to this and be like, I could do that, you totally can. You can. I encourage you to.
So this thing that you're doing, is mm-hmm. that like a long-term thing, or could someone, if someone were coming to New Orleans for the week or the weekend, mm-hmm. Could they find out if you had openings in your schedule?
Yeah, kind of it's literally, yeah. You reach out to me. I think there's you can click in. On the website, you can actually, it tells you about it, but you can also just email me or yeah, connect. It's not something where I'm like, my next one is on March such and such. It's like we together make a date that works for both of us.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
You know, one thing I do want to add, that just literally hit me that is so wonderful about this entire approach to being outside is it's also very accessible.
Yes.
If you have mobility issues, if you're just yep. old and slow like me, you know what? You know, you're not talking about killing yourself doing 8 miles on a mountain before dawn. You know,
no, exactly.
It's exactly really for everybody.
Just going somewhere that feels a little extra wild to you and being there. Step off the trail for a few feet and sit and see what happens. Yeah.
Well, I can tell you that. Like, honestly, this weekend, I'm going somewhere to be by myself. I have we have a local park. They have little benches in front of the stream. 500 mm-hmm. people will walk behind me, but they won't bother me and I won't notice
no,
them.
Exactly. Yep. Yeah, and sometimes, yep, exactly. If you just get a little ways, all of that, whatever's going on, it's not in your space, basically.
Mm-hmm. I want to encourage all of you that are listening to this, do this. You know, I did not realize when I first started hiking, I hiked by myself because I was so uncomfortable to hike with other people. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize I was learning to be comfortable in the outdoors, but I had, honestly, I won't lie to you, until this conversation, I had forgotten how long it had been for me and how much it feeds my heart and soul and how yeah. it's just worth every bit of effort.
Yeah.
Go try it.
If you're listening to this, you may connect to a longing of like, oh, yes, I would, that would be so nice. So yeah, find a way to
find a way.
to do something like that for yourselves and reach out. If any, I love to talk about this stuff. I love to, you know, think about places to go. I just love to support people in thinking about it, or just hear good stories too from people who, because I know there are people who've done all kinds of neat things. Yeah.
Well, so our regular listeners, you know the drill. Every one of Carla's links are on the show notes, and Carla's got great ones. She got, of course, Instagram. She got LinkedIn. Your meetup group is on there, and your website. And I really, again, I encourage all of you to go look. Your website's beautiful anyway. It's peaceful and it's wonderful. And we get to read about the Mary Oliver poem, which every single time I've heard you speak about it, I feel my blood quicken, if that makes sense. That reminder that our life is wild and precious. And I think we forget that in the everyday. So please go visit all her links. And just as an aside, I know that this particular episode's not about life coaching, but she is extraordinary, honestly. And if you've never had a life coaching session, it's amazing in more ways than I can tell you. And life coaching is for everyone.
Well, thank you. And the way it's similar to what we're just talking about, it's very much about connecting you with what matters to you. You know, so sometimes people think it's about somebody telling you what to do, or being like, oh, I'm going to, you know, give you a set of goals or something like that. But it's really about following your own longing for your life and then taking the steps to get to what matters to you, which is basically what we've been talking about today in terms of this is what I'm doing when I go alone to the woods. And it only needs to make sense to me. And it's something that just feeds my soul.
And if you should choose to change your approach right now, you could go in another direction.
Exactly. If you want to change your route or stop here, you can do something else. Yeah, exactly.
You get to make it up. Oh, Carla, you just get more wonderful every single time I talk to you. Oh. And I just thank you so much. Thank you for being somebody that's been supportive of Trail Dames and somebody that we've all just been so inspired by for all these years. And we will talk again soon for sure.
Oh, well, that sounds great. And likewise, everything mirrored right back to you. Always a pleasure. And just so honored to be here in this incredible community that you've created and nurtured for 200 episodes. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. We're going to bring this episode of the Trail Days podcast to a close. Thank you again, Carla. And I hope tomorrow morning when you go out, if you go out for your walk, I hope you see wonderful, amazing things.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Anna.
So do you all feel more peaceful after listening to Carla talk about being in the woods? I know I do. There's just something about her delivery and her reminders of all the just simple, small beauties that are out there. And I was serious this weekend. I'm going out. I'm not going to go far, but I'm going to go for some peace and some quiet and some blessings. So I have to tell you on a personal nature, I don't think I've ever done anything in my entire life consistently for 200 weeks in a row. I can't think of a single thing I did. I didn't practice my cello that consistently. I didn't rehair bows that consistently at the violin shop. And I'm super proud of this. Now, I will tell you, it literally, not a chance in Hades this would have happened without Steve, our producer. If I hadn't had to commit to him, and if I hadn't had him helping me every step along the way, it wouldn't have happened. And this isn't like one of those Oscar speeches where they're really just pretending to thank people. I'm being dead serious. It wouldn't have happened without him. But I am super proud, and I'm not planning on stopping anytime soon. Heck, I think we could have Carla back for episode 300, 400, maybe even 500. For now, I have to tell you, Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for listening. Thank you for being here. Thank you for reaching out and sending me great people to call and interview. And I'm always here. You can email me at info@traildames.com if you have anyone you want to be on the podcast that you think would make for a great conversation. Now, like I said, we're not going to have a mud butt journal entry today. I think that this episode is perfect as it is. I'll bring that back after our next big interview. But for now, thank you. Thank you for listening. Thank you for being part of the podcast. And thank you for supporting the Hiking Radio Network. Now, go hike.